Science communication and popularization initiatives across the world are working towards a unified goal, a collective development of scientific temper in the society. However, it is evident that even all the SciComm platforms put together are being stretched to achieve this humongous goal. A certain section of world leaders are still denying climate change, the evolutionary theory still needs to be defended, and we are seeing the rise of unscientific movements such as those led by flat earthers, anti-vaxxers, and anti-maskers in most recent times. In the following segment, Professor Soumitra Banerjee from ISER Kolkata will speak about the need for scientific temper and the development of an appreciation for science and scientific method. Professor Banerjee is a faculty of the Department of Physical Sciences and the principal investigator of the Nonlinear Dynamics Lab at ISER Kolkata since 2009. Before this, Professor Banerjee served a long stint at the Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. Professor Banerjee has served as associate editor for the IEEE Transactions on Circuits and Systems 2 from 2003 to 2005 and an associate editor for the IEEE Transactions on Circuits and Systems 1 between 2006 and 2007. He is a recipient of the prestigious Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in 2003 and was recognized as a highly cited author by Thomson Reuters from 2004 to 2014. He is a fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences, the Indian National Academy of Engineering, the Indian National Science Academy, the World Academy of Sciences, and the IEEE. Apart from research, he takes special interest in the history of science and is also known for his scientific outreach efforts. He is associated with the Breakthrough Science Society, which envisions to propagate scientific thinking among the masses. He was also one of the active members in mobilizing the India chapter for the Global March for Science.
The Cogito team has requested me to talk about the various shades of unscientific beliefs and thinking that are prevalent in our society in India, as well as all over the globe. The point essentially is, I don't need to enumerate the different types of unscientific thinking that starts from beliefs in various non-existing things to unscientific way of interpreting history and all that put together. There are people worldwide who believe that the earth is flat. There are people who refuse to wear the mask during the COVID times, and there are various kinds of beliefs and practices. But our focus today, I would like to focus on why do you have this? Even though the fact is that ever since the time of Renaissance and Enlightenment, there is a global movement to propagate the scientific way of thinking, but still after say 300 years of that time, we still have this kind of thinking prevalent. Why? The first thing that I could figure out was that through the whole educative process that we have in India, we hardly ever get an opportunity to learn how science teaches us to think. Science is not just a collection of subjects. It is a way of thinking. Now, that way of thinking is not propagated through our normal educative process. Science is taught as a collection of subjects, physics, chemistry, mathematics, geology, biology, and all that is sort of presented as a set of information. At no stage of the educative process do we come to know that science teaches us not to believe anything without evidence. And as a result, in their daily life, if they come across something that is a belief prevalent in the society without evidence, they tend to believe. Why do they believe? Because others believe. Now, this is a medieval kind of thinking. We were expected to get rid of it through the educative process. Didn't happen. Take, for example, the way we learn history. History is taught as a collection of things that happen. A sequence of things, the kings, queens, generals, and fights, wars, sequence of events. And as far as I'm concerned, when I studied history in my school days, I was never told how we came to know that these are true, that this really happened, that there was really a king called Harshvardhan, that there was some time when in the distant past there was the Indus Valley civilization, then there was a Vedic civilization. Why and how did we come to know that? We were only told that this happened. And we were never told how we came to know that this really happened. As a result, if somebody presents one narrative against another, it is basically a person's personal choice as to which one to believe. And this is a major problem in our country right now. So I would rather pin down the problem to the way the education happens in this country. It's not really a scientific education, even though students study science. And those who have gone through that educative process, and finally we are now in a sort of coveted position, I would say. Some are teaching, some are learning at the highest level, PhD and all. They have responsibility to undo and counter the wrongs in the way the present generation is learning. That means we have a responsibility in telling them what actually science entails. We have a responsibility in telling them how they should learn how to think. Now, this is something that we have to do. And unfortunately, this is a sort of a struggle that started quite some time back. I suppose you know, at some point of time, there was an Indian Renaissance spearheaded by Ishwarchandra Vidyasagar, whose 200th year we are observing now. And after he sort of forced the British, or he initiated a sort of teaching and learning of science, and he propagated a scientific way of thinking, rational way of thinking. Soon after him, we see a spark of doing science in India, Prafulla Chandra Ray, J.C. Bose, Meghnad Shah, Satyendranath Bose, a plethora of scientists. And through them, we see that there was a constant struggle to establish science as against various kinds of belief systems. Unfortunately, after them, especially after independence, science for the scientific community has more or less become like a failure, just a failure. And because of that, the sort of struggle to establish a scientific way of thinking in the society, that has taken a back seat, and our own careeristic motives have taken a front seat, and that is one problem. So my appeal to the younger generation, upcoming generation, would be A, to take the message of science as a mission. To take it to the people, to the generation that is being educated now, to the students today, and to continue the struggle that Vidyasagar, Prafulla Chandra Ray, Meghnad Saha, and people like that initiated.